Hi everyone, in this video I'm going to continue with the analysis of oriented site percolation in two dimensions. So I'm showing you here pictures of the process. I defined rigorously the process in the previous video. And in this previous video, we also proved the theorem that you see here at the top of the slide that says that the percolation probability for the case of oriented site percolation in two dimensions is a non-decreasing function of the density of open sites. So this monotonicity result implies that oriented site percolation exhibits at most one phase transition. And so this also motivates the definition of critical value right after the theorem. So PC is going to be the largest value for the density of open edges such that percolation is not possible. Now, monotonicity implies that for P less than this critical value, we don't have percolation. For P larger than this critical value PC, we must have a percolation with positive probability. But now in this video and the next one, I'm going to prove the two theorems you see at the bottom of the slide, which together give an upper bound and a lower bound for the critical value PC, and in particular prove that PC is not degenerate. PC is not equal to 0 or 1, which means that indeed we have existence of a unique phase transition. So here is the inequality again we want to prove, and the idea of the proof is going to be to do some kind of comparison between oriented site percolation in two dimensions and Galton-Watson branching processes. So I already defined this type of processes in a previous playlist about martingale theory, and what's the only result you need to know about Galton-Watson branching processes to understand this proof is the fact that if you have a branching process where the expected number of offspring per individual is strictly less than one, then the process is going to go extinct with probability one. So how do we do this? Well, the idea is going to be to start with only one wet site, so the one at zero, and we are going to go to look at the cluster starting from zero growing, and we are going to look at the total number of wet sites at level three. If we can prove that at least in average, the number of wet sites at level three is strictly less than one, then that's it. We have, by comparison with Galton-Watson branching processes, that there cannot be percolation, and that's what's going to give us the result. So now, why am I choosing level three? That's just because if you choose a lower level, the bond is not going to be as good. But if you choose a higher level, like four, for instance, then the calculation I'm going to do become very messy. Okay, so three is good. It's a little bit tricky, but not too much. So the idea is the following. So let's look at, so site zero here, that's the origin. Then I'm going to go up to level three. So I'm looking at this, basically, this kind of picture. So I have one more site here, here, and here. So here I'm at level two, and I'm going to go one more step here, 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 and here. So that's what the graph looks like. If you look at the graph starting at the origin and you stop at level three, so this is zero. And so here you are going to have a site, at this level you are going to have one, three, and negative one, negative three, okay? That's both sites. And so what we want to do is, assuming that this site is wet, and all those sites after this one are open with probability P, what is the expected number of vertices here that are going to be wet? So to do this, we are going to use a linearity of the expected value and say that the expected number of sites here that are wet is exactly the expected number of wet sites here is just the probability that three is wet, and then same here and here. So in fact, we can express the probability, or I should say the expected number of sites that are wet at level three as probability that -3 is wet, plus the probability that -1 is wet, plus the probability that 1 is wet, and so on. And so that's the goal. Computing the probability that 3 or -3 are wet, it's pretty easy. I'm going to start with that. So probability that, and I'm going to write a P here again to remind you the parameter of the process. So that's going to be this little P, the probability that sites are open. So now, the event that 3 is wet is exactly the event that 3 belongs to the set W3. We are going to look at plus or minus. So let's look at plus only. So 3 is in W3. And so here clearly, if this is wet, the only way this one is also wet is if this site and this site and this site are open. So if those three sites are open, indeed this site is going to be wet, the water can go through here. But if one of those three sites is not open, then this cannot occur. And so indeed, so let's imagine, for instance, to again explain the orientation. So let's assume that those three sites are open and also this one, but not this one. So you may think, well, we can go up here and up, up, and then go back here, except that you cannot go down, okay? Everything is going up. You have a directed graph. So if this one is wet and this one is open, that doesn't mean that this one is going to be wet. This one can only be wet from that one, okay? So that means from this picture that the probability that 3 is indeed wet at level 3 is going to be equal to P at the power 1, 2, 3. That's the probability that those three sites are simultaneously open. So that's P squared. Now, what about this site 1 here? So I'm not going to write the probability that -3 is wet. That's exactly the same by symmetry. Now the next step is to look at the probability that 1 is wet, and this one is more difficult. More difficult because there are multiple possible open paths to go from 0 to 1. So what you can do is go always on the right like that. So maybe I'm going to draw another picture here. Maybe let's rotate that and do a rectangle like that. So I'm going to have something that looks like this. Okay, so the origin eventually is here and my site 1 is here. Okay, if I just rotate the picture like that. And so I have three ways to go from the origin. So I'm going to write 0 here and 1 there. I have three different ways to go from here to here, going only up or left. I can go up twice and then left, or up once, left and up, or left, up, up, okay? And so I'm going to basically draw a picture of those three possible paths. So I need those ones to be open, okay? So if those ones are open, I can indeed go through here. Another possibility, I'm redoing the picture here with 1 and 0 here. So is that this is open and this one is open and this one is open. That's a second path that leads me to 1. And then the third possibility is if, again, we have 0 and 1, is if this is open, this is open, and this is open. Okay, so if those three sites are open, then that means that 1 is wet. But if those three sites are open, also this site is going to be wet, and also those three ones. Again, be careful, that's kind of a rotation. So here by this path, I mean you go right and then left. Here you go right, left, right. And for this one, you go left and twice right. Okay, so we have those pictures. And now from that, we can compute this probability. So the event that the probability that 1 is wet at level 3 is exactly the probability that those three sites are open, or those three sites are open, or those three sites are open. So we have basically three events here that I'm going to call A1, A2, and A3. And in fact, this event that one is in W3 is exactly the event A1 union A2 union A3. Now, how can we compute the probability of a union? Well, to be very precise and to have a better bond, what we are going to do is really compute the probability of the union explicitly by using the inclusion-exclusion identity. So have in mind that those three events are not mutually exclusive. Okay, it's possible that several of them occur and so on. And so the probability of the union is not equal to the sum of the probability. That's a little bit more complicated than that. So let's write this. This is equal to the probability of A1 union A2 union A3. So now, using inclusion exclusion, again, that's something I define, I explained in a previous video, first playlist about measure theory and probability. So inclusion exclusion identity tells you that P, that this is equal to P of A1 plus P of A2 plus P of A3 minus the probability of intersection of two events. So that's going to be P of A1 intersection A2 minus P of A1 intersection A3, and then minus P of A2 intersection A3. Then we need one more term, plus, so you see plus, then minus, then I need to end with a plus, and now I'm looking at intersection of all three events. So plus the probability of A1 intersection A2 intersection A3. Now all those probabilities are very easy to compute. You just look at the picture. It's just a counting problem, and by counting I don't even mean combinatorics, I really mean counting on your fingers. So for A1, you need for A1 to occur. So I remind you that we don't count this vertex here. I should cross out those ones because we assume that this is wet at level zero. So we don't have to worry about this one. This one is open with probability one. What we want to know is whether those ones are open or not. So you see that for A1 to occur, you need exactly three vertices to be open. They are independently open with probability P. So P of A1 is equal to P cube. Same for this one and same for this one. Each time you have three vertices. So that means that those three terms are each equal to P cube. So we start with a 3P cube. Then after, what about A1 intersection A2? So that means that all the vertices in this picture, like the three vertices here and the three there, should all be open. How many vertices it is? Well, that's going to be 1, 2, 3, and this fourth one here, those ones are in common. So that's a P at the power 4. So here we have minus P4. Then what about A1 intersection A3? So 1 and 3, so you have those three vertices here. So that's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So that gives you a minus P5. What about this term? So you have A2 intersection A3. You need those three ones to be open and also those three ones. So that gives you a total of 1, 2, 3, 4 vertices must be open. So that's a minus P4. And then all together open, but again, you have a lot of overlap. So that means that you have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 that must be open so that all three events occur simultaneously. So that gives you another P5. So here you have a plus P5. So now this simplifies a little bit. The P5 here cancel each other. And so you end up with 3P³ minus 2P4. So I'm going to write that here. That's what we just found from this little picture. So that's equal to 3P³ minus 2P4. Okay, so now I can erase all this. So of course, the probability that negative 1 is in W3 by symmetry is going to be exactly the same. And so from this, you can conclude that the expected value, so when the parameter is p of the number of vertices in W3, so I'm going to write like this absolute value of W3. So this is going to be, again, bilinearly, that's just the probability that 3 is in W3 plus 1 is plus probability that 1 is in the set plus and so on. So you just have to add those probabilities. And so that's the sum of those two ones, but times 2, because we are also there are also those two sets. So if you add them up, you get 4P³. So times 2, that's 8P³. So that gives you some 8P³. And then here, you must have a minus 4 P at the power 4. Okay, so that gives you the expected number of wet sites, expected number of wet sites at level 3. So now what I'm arguing is that if this is less than 1, then that should imply that theta p, the percolation probability, is equal to 0. And so the reason for that, it's again by comparison with those Galton-Watson branching processes. So here you can really think of this side 0 as some kind of parent, and you can think of the wet vertices at level 3 as the offspring of this initial wet site. Now, saying that that the number of offspring here, or number of wet sites, is in average strictly less than 1, means that you can somehow, using this kind of rescaling where one generation in your Galton-Watson branching process corresponds to 3 level in your oriented site percolation, then doing this kind of comparison, you can argue that, well, if this wet site cannot generate in average more than one wet site, then the process of wet sites is going to die out by comparison with Galton-Watson branching processes. And but in fact, it's interesting also to notice that the converse is not true. You can think maybe that if at the opposite this is strictly more than 1, then the probability of percolation should be strictly positive. We should be in the supercritical case. In fact, that's not the fact. And why is it the case that you can compare the two processes one way but not the other way around? Well, that's because that assuming that you have maybe two wet sites at level 3, it's possible that you are going to find, starting from, let's say those two ones are wet, maybe starting from those two ones, you are going to find two open paths of length 3 that are going to generate a priori two more wet sites. The problem is that the two paths of length 3 starting from those two ones may end up at the same site. So you have some kind of looking at the point of view of oriented site percolation because of this spatial structure and explicit space. You have some kind of possible overlap in the offspring. And so that means that it's possible for this expected value to be strictly larger than 1, but still, this is 0 because here in this case you cannot do the comparison with branching processes. At the opposite, At the opposite, you have it the other way around. If this is less than one, and on top of that, you have some possible overlap that is going to make you lose even more of spring, then it's clear that in this case, this kind of Galton-Watson branching process that would keep track of the set of wet sites at level 0, 3, 6, 9, and so on, at all the multiples of 3, this process should die out. So that kind of explains why we have this. And so now how do we conclude this? So it looks like now I'm talking about something that has nothing to do with this value, but in fact the proof is done now. What you can easily check using a calculator is the fact that for all p less than this value, okay, this inequality here is true, okay? If you take p less than 0.557, then 8p cubed minus 4p at the power 4 is going to be less than 1, which means that for all p less than that, there is no percolation. And so that means that the critical value indeed should be larger than this number. And so indeed, this shows the theorem.